So, yes, so I am from Technical University Braunschweig, and I'm working at the Institute of Mathematical Stochastics. Yes, so we start with classical diffusion. So when one speaks about classical diffusion, then the basic equation in this context is, of course, the heat equation. And it is a classical result that the solution of such an equation with initial condition U0 can be given in terms of Brownian motion. So in this context, we say that what we have here, so this formula provides us stochastic solution, and Brownian motion provides us stochastic solution of heat equation. And what are the main features of classical diffusions? They are that the underlying process is Brownian motion, and hence variance is T. And this is reflects in observations that the mean square displacement of diffusing particles is proportional to the time increments. This is one hand, so one feature of classical diffusion. And another feature is that underlying process, namely Brownian motion, is a Gaussian process. Of course, one can discuss the whole class of diffusion equations, but they all have these two features, Gaussian processes, and mean square displacement is proportional to the time increment. But quite recently, there are many observations which show us that not only classical but also anomalous diffusion can take place. And what does mean anomalous diffusion? This means that mean square displacement of particles, of diffusing particles, is no more proportional to time increments. That is, the diffusion can be slower or faster, and this can happen that the underlying stochastic processes are no more Gaussian. And such types of diffusion have been observed in many different systems, in biology, physics, and chemistry, and there is a huge amount of literature where one can find some examples and models. One can speak about subdiffusion, that is the diffusion which is slower than the classical one, or superdiffusion, which is faster than the classical one. And there are different approaches how to model such things. And when one starts with continuous time random walks, then one arrives to basic equation. So once again, when one speaks about classical diffusion, then the basic equation is the heat equation. When one speaks about anomalous diffusion, then the basic equation is the so-called fractional heat equation. That is, we have, instead of Laplacian, we have fractional Laplacian, and instead of first derivative with respect to time, we have fractional, Caputo fractional derivatives with respect to time. And so this guy is responsible for slowing down the diffusion, and this guy is responsible for speeding up the diffusion, because this fractional Laplacian is actually the generator of a Levy process, so jumps, actually big jumps of particles are admissible. So this equation one can rewrite in Riemann-Liouville formalism in this way. So this is a kind of integral equation. So this is the generator of a semigroup, and this is the memory kernel. So this is our basic equation, and this is our basic memory kernel, so with this constant. And so this is the basic equation. It belongs to a general class. This general class can be written in this way. So once again, L is the generator of a strongly continuous semigroup, generated by some Markov process. Let us see, it's like this today. And K is some memory kernel. And of course, such type of equations are were discussed in the literature for a quite long time, but usually for particular classes of kernels. So the most studied case is, of course, the kernels of convolution types. For such kernels of convolution type, in particular, kernels which are related to some Bernstein functions, namely, we consider K, kernel of convolution type, such that this function K has Laplace transform of this form 1 over H, where H is some Bernstein function. So it's a special class of functions. Then everything is related to Levy subordinators, and actually to Levy, to inverse subordinators. And it is a well-known result in the literature. Then in this case, so for such type of kernels, so K has this type of Laplace transform, then it is known that stochastic solution of such type of equation can be given in terms of this process, what is what here. So Xi is just a Markov process with generator L, and H of T is the inverse subordinator which corresponds to this Bernstein function H. Hence, so this guy corresponds to our kernel theory. So this is a there are many authors who have contributed to this result, and so the recent papers are due to Kolokaltsov, where one has generalized all this to this setting. So this is one class of processes which are used to obtain stochastic solutions of such type of equations. Quite recently, there is another type of processes which is used to obtain stochastic solutions of such equations. Namely, they are the so-called randomly scaled Gaussian processes. What is it? So these are processes of this type, product of A and G. G is a Gaussian process, not necessarily Markovian, but Gaussian. And A is a random variable which is independent from the process G and which is non-negative. So A is just the so-called random scaling. And the most known representative of this family of randomly scaled Gaussian processes is the so-called generalized Gray-Brownian motion. This is a two-parameter family of processes which generalize Brownian motion, Gray-Brownian motion, fractional Brownian motion, and one can realize this family of processes like this. So one can one takes a fractional Brownian motion with Hurst parameter alpha half, and then run a particular random variable which is independent from fractional Brownian motion and positive, and actually given in terms of its Laplace transform. Its Laplace transform is nothing else but the Mittag-Leffler function with index beta. Beta, I have not written it anywhere, but beta is from 0 to 1, as before. Well, so this is a family of processes. So once again, fractional Brownian motion is not a Markov process. It has memory, so to say. But such processes have some nice properties, namely, they are self-similar processes with stationary increments. And these two properties are nice for modeling, for statistical properties. And it is known that using this generalized Gray-Brownian motion, one can construct solutions of this equation. This equation is called governing equation for generalized Gray-Brownian motion. And if you look at this equation carefully, you see that this kernel K memory kernel is not of convolution type. So as generator L, we have Laplacian here. So it is a kind of time fractional heat equation. And actually, it is a dressed or the time stretch time fractional heat equation, because if we use just this time change, we can reduce everything to just a time fractional heat equation. So alpha is equal to 2, and beta is beta. So everything reduces to time fractional heat equation. So you see, so for such equations, so at least in principle, one can consider this class of equations where memory kernel K is not of convolution type. And when one constructs stochastic solutions in terms of some processes, randomly scaled Gaussian processes. Probably one more remark than in previous approach, when we considered Markov processes subordinated with respect to inverse subordinators, then Markov processes is, of course, Markov process, but inverse subordinator is not a Markov process. And then so constructed process is also not Markov. And solutions of such type of equations, they do not possess the semigroup property. But yeah, somehow they are related to semigroups due to this generator of a semigroup here inside the equation. Okay, so what happens? We have, roughly speaking, the same time fractional heat equation, and we have two completely different classes of processes which can be used to solve such to construct representations of solutions of such equation. Moreover, quite recently, there is another result of Pagnini-Paradisi 2016. There we have constructed another randomly scaled Gaussian process, which provides stochastic solutions for a time and space fractional heat equation. So it's quite interesting because this fractional Laplacian, once again, this is the generator of a Levy process, pure jump Levy process. But nevertheless, stochastic solutions are given in terms of randomly scaled Gaussian processes. So it's quite interesting and kind of a mystery. And so these two types of results were somehow starting points for our discussion, for our investigation. And then I'm coming to our research. This is a joint work with Christian Bender from Saarland University. So we consider general class of evolution equations of this type, that is with memory kernel. L is the generator of a Markov process with a strongly continuous semigroup on some Banach space. And so first questions which are interesting for us is which classes of processes can be used to solve such evolution equations. And so we know for a particular case of time fractional heat equation, we have two different classes of processes, a subordinated Markov process and randomly scaled Gaussian process. So why this type of question of processes? What is in common between these two classes of processes? So this is another question which we were interested in. And now I will present you quite fast some of our results. You can read first results in this direction in this preprint in archive, available in archive. And today I will mention just a few results from this paper. And we start first of all with the setting. So once again, we consider a general class of such equations. For the simplicity, let L be the generator of a Levy process. That is, it is a pseudo-differential operator with a symbol minus psi. So it works like this. So we apply Fourier transform, then multiply with a symbol, and then apply inverse Fourier transform. And this symbol minus psi, so this psi belongs to a special class of functions called continuous negative definite functions. And we also assume that psi of zero is zero. That is, so this all corresponds to Levy processes without killing, so with infinite lifetime. So this is our first assumption about the generator L. Second assumption about initial data, again, for simplicity, we assume that our initial data are from Schwarz space. So everything is d-dimensional in this equation. And we consider a quite general class of memory kernels K. It is written here, so I will just comment what is what here. So we assume that as a function of this second variable, K is a little bit better than L1. So this, for some epsilon, this norm is finite. And as a function of first variable t, this function k may explode when t tends to zero. But this explosion must be controllable. Namely, we can compensate this explosion by some positive power of t. And then this epsilon appears here and here. So the better the function k is with respect to s, the worse it can be with respect to t, so to say. Okay, so this is a quite general assumption. So we have a quite general class of memory kernels, and then some of the results. Yes, first of all, once again, the setting. So we consider a probability space and some RD-valued stochastic process, which is centered, which starts at zero. And we say that this process X provides a stochastic solution to this equation star if the following function defined in this way solves the equation. And it happens for all initial data from our Schwarz space. So we are looking for processes which are admissible for giving a solution of this equation star in this form. So this is the task and then some results. Oh yes, first of all, a small remark. Of course, if we are able to solve this equation, so if we have the corresponding process XT and we are able to construct such a solution, then we can, of course, make some time change, not probably change of variables. So just new variable tau is equal to G of T. And then we are able to solve, just making this change of variable, we are able to solve a bigger class of equations, just inserting instead of t. Probably I should do on the contrary. So t is just g of tau. And then in terms of tau, this new variable tau, we have for many nice functions g, we have a class of equations and a class of corresponding solutions. So this is written here. So in terms of good functions G, which can be considered as time stretchings or dressings, so we do this change of variable, and then our original star equation will be transformed in another equation. The kernel will be transformed, and then the solution will be transformed. And this is nothing else but the time change. But in terms of time stretching, which is relevant to generalized Gregorian motion, it's worth to mention this. Okay, yes, now about the results. So we are considering this type of equations with K as in our assumptions, and L also, and U0. And we construct first a function phi. We construct it starting from our kernel K. So we use only K. Using K, we construct the coefficients by iterations, by recurrent formulas. And then we consider this function phi. And the first statement is that this function is well-defined and entire on the whole complex plane. And why this function phi? Very simple. Probably will say it a little bit later. Yes. So first of all, a real statement, first real statement of the result. So our equation star has at least one stochastic solution. That is, there is a stochastic process which can be used to represent the solution of this equation star, if and only if this function, this is a composition of my phi, once again, phi corresponds to K, and psi, this is the symbol of our generator L. So we have two characteristics in our equation, memory kernel K and generator L. And so we use both of them to construct this guy. So if and only if this function is positive definite with respect to this variable, we can hope to construct stochastic solution of our evolution equation. And in this case, any process XT which provides such stochastic solution should satisfy this equality. That is, characteristic function of each random variable XT is given in terms of this exactly this composition, phi and psi. So once again, phi and psi, this is something which is constructed from memory kernel and Levy generator of our evolution equation. So why this result looks like this? So everything is very simple. So we just consider this function u of tx, which is just expectation of u0, x plus xt. We insert this guy into our equation star, apply a Fourier transform, and then we arrive to such equality. So you see the characteristics of our stochastic process are related to characteristics of our equation, psi and k. And this is then a finite dimensional Volterra equation of second type, and one can solve it. And then the solution can be obtained by Banach fixed point argument and Picard iterations. And this is exactly what you construct as a solution. Okay, so it's quite simple, but nevertheless, it's quite general result. So for a big class of equations, stochastic solutions can be obtained if and only if this composition is positive definite. That is, there is a stochastic process such that its characteristic function can be equal to this function. And then this is the result. And then some particular things. If, moreover, this function phi is good enough, namely it is completely monotone for each t, then one can use such type of process for solving our original evolution equation star. What in this process? So this y, it's a Levy process with generator L. So y, it's a Levy process with generator L. And A of T, it's a family of random variables which are independent of Y, which are non-negative, actually. And they are given in terms of this function phi. So Laplace transforms of these random variables are given in terms of this function phi. So this A of T, this corresponds to our memory kernel. corresponds to phi, of first of all, but this phi corresponds to memory kernel. Well, so if our function phi is good enough, namely completely monotone, then it is a Laplace transform of some measure, and so we can construct stochastic solutions in terms of such process. Moreover, we can use also the kind of subordination result, namely if our psi, our symbol psi, is just a subordination, that is a composition of some Bernstein function f and some continuous negative definite function psi tilde, then one can construct stochastic solution in this form, where now this y tilde corresponds not to the whole generator, but to this symbol minus psi, and then this a tilde corresponds to composition of phi and f. This is again a nice function under our assumption, and then one obtains this result. What does it mean in particular? For example, if we as symbol consider the symbol of fractional Laplacian, then fractional Laplacian is a subordination of power function, which is a Bernstein function, and a symbol of Laplacian. So we can split it into two times, into two parts, and then solve such kind of equation with our approach. So this is a first statement, but the most interesting case is when our kernel is homogeneous. So this is what means that the kernel is homogeneous. In this case, our function phi is also homogeneous. And actually, phi of t lambda is nothing else but phi of 1, and then t to the power beta lambda. And hence, in this case, so when then the kernel is homogeneous, then we have this equality. And then in our construction, so once again, a stochastic solution, we can use such a process. But due to this time homogeneity, instead of a of t, so we can use only one random variable a, and then t beta, where random variable a, this a is just given in terms of function phi of 1. So this simplifies our time change, so to say. Good, I see that I have just a few minutes. I know that I do everything very fast, but this is a kind of advertisement of the paper of Budko and Bender. So in the special case, we have started exactly with this special case. This is the kernel of time fractional heat equation. You see that this is, of course, a homogeneous kernel. And then so we use our approach. We calculate all the coefficients. And the corresponding function phi, so this is our phi of 1 point. So the corresponding function phi is nothing else but the Mittag-Leffler function. And we know that, so in this case we have this plus, but this guy is completely monotone. So such function satisfies all our assumptions. That is, our kernel satisfies our assumptions. And then due to the statement of theorem 1, we have the following solution, stochastic solution. So this is the stochastic solution, and this is the equation. So I have just added this as time stretching, but nevertheless, what you see here, you see, roughly speaking, time stretched time fractional heat equation. This is the governing equation of generalized Gray-Brownian motion. And this stochastic solution, we use not generalized Gray-Brownian motion, but Brownian motion with this time change, and you see that of course Brownian motion is a stable process, self-similar stable process. So instead of this process, what is written here, we can use another process. Namely, we can pull out this random variable, and we can pull out it as a random scaling. So we will obtain something like this. So in one hand, we know that generalized Gray-Brownian motion can be used to solve this equation. So this is one process which gives us stochastic solution. This is a known result. Our result that this type of process can be used to solve the same equation. So this is again randomly scaled, but Brownian motion, slowed down Brownian motion, but this guy is a Markov process, which is nicer for some calculations. And also this can be rewritten in this way. Okay, I have some further examples, but I don't have time. So probably I just come back to the original questions. So we have this class of equations, and we have two classes, two questions. So first question, which classes of process can be used to solve such equations? And what is in common between two known approaches? So I just allow myself to use a few seconds to connect these two guys. So as I said, so Markov process subordinated with respect to inverse subordinator. It is just a special case of our result when we have Markov process subordinated with respect to some AT. So we have used Levy process, but the same can be done for just a general Markov process. So this is our general result. Moreover, in case when our kernel is homogeneous, this A of t can be replaced by just random variable multiplied with t beta. Moreover, if our process psi is stable and self-similar, then we can pull out this R in front of the process, and then we obtain R in some power psi t beta. So we have here Markov process, slowed down Markov process, and randomly scaled, slowed down Markov process. And the next step, the last step, so this process, for example, if psi is Brownian motion, we can replace this guy by fractional Brownian motion, or if psi is a stable Levy process, we can replace this guy by linear fractional Levy motion, and we are coming back to some, so let me do like this. So we arrive to something which is similar to generalized Gray-Brownian motion. So this is the whole chain which combines these two guys, these two different classes of processes. Yeah, and they have different advantages and disadvantages. And so, yeah, this is the answer. And one more remark that, of course, our approach not only clarifies what classes of processes can be used, but it also allows to construct new couples of K and phi. So construct new stochastic solutions for new classes of equations. I do not give any particular details, but just say that for such kernel, terrible kernel with special function, the so-called Zeiger-Mayer kernel, so this is the K, and the corresponding phi can be found. This is just a three-parameter Mittag-Leffler function. So the result is that we have a solution in terms of this process where A has this Laplace transform. And there are many other results which you can find in the paper. So thank you very much. Sorry for eating so much time, but I'm completely finished.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
I suspect it was too fast.
Yeah, I have a question, if I may.
Yeah.
So Jana, first of all, I would like to say that this is a really beautiful theorem. I'm really taken by its beauty. But to take home message for me would be to say that if you can clarify, so this kernel that is in the original formulation of your problem, this little k kernel,
yes,
is usually responsible for either time change or random scaling or a kind of subordination, yes?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Yes. It's really beautiful. Thank you very much.
Well, may I ask a question too? You said, so those equations are typically not governed by semigroups, of course.
So once again?
Sorry?
I have not heard quite well. What did you say?
You said those equations, which you consider, are typically not solved by semigroups. But
not really, not true. So they are solved by semigroups in which sense? So this is the equation.
Okay.
So this is L, this is the generator of a semigroup.
Okay.
And this is known, wait a minute. So in terms of this first guy, this is roughly speaking solved by semigroup. What is what here?
Yeah.
So this is nothing else but, integral from 0 to infinity. Then here state a semigroup generated by L. Semigroup generated by L, but we subordinate it with respect to probability function of this guy X, HP. So you see, this is so if you know the semigroup, let me kill all things. That if you know the semigroup generated by this Markov process Xi, if you know transition kernel of this, not transition kernel, probability density function of this inverse subordinator, then you are done.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So right. Semigroups are there actually.
Yeah.
In this context, in this approach, yeah.
What about the long-term behavior for those equations? So for positive semigroups, there are a lot of theorems which tell you if you have this or that assumption, then it converges as time tends to infinity. Can you have something similar for those kind of equations?
Well, I have not thought about it. So our aim was to understand how such equations are related to which kind of processes.
Okay.
That's all. Now you have some job to do to clarify long-term behavior.
Thanks.
Welcome.
Okay.